Welcome to the Stanford Women's Health Podcast Series. I'm Dr. Sharon Hung, Director of Women's Health for the Primary Care and Population Health Department at Stanford. From debunking myths to exploring the latest research, we will delve into the world of women's health with leading experts in the field. Dr. Melinda Telly is a medical oncologist at Stanford Healthcare and a professor of medicine in the Division of Medical Oncology at Stanford University School of Medicine. She serves as the director of the breast cancer program at the Stanford Cancer Institute and associate director of the Stanford Women's Cancer Center. Her research centers on creating new treatments for triple-negative and hereditary cancers, and she's been involved in the clinical development of PARP inhibitors for BRCA1 and 2 mutation-associated cancers. Dr. Telly currently also serves as the co-chair of the ASCO Guideline Advisory Group and a member of the NCCN Breast Cancer Guideline Panel. She's recognized for her numerous contributions to advancing breast cancer treatments through innovative research. Dr. Telly, it's just such an honor to speak with you today. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me, and hello, everyone.
I've been really looking forward to our conversation today, since even though you, as the oncologist, navigate the breast cancer treatment options with our patients, we as the primary care providers or gynecologists are often the ones breaking the news about the diagnosis of breast cancer with our patients who have numerous questions about what lies ahead of them. So I'd like to talk to you about kind of treatment options for DCIS as well as invasive breast cancer today. So starting with DCIS, there's been some ongoing debate regarding kind of overdiagnosis, overtreatment of DCIS, particularly as we're moving towards screening in 40s instead of 50s. Can you talk about DCIS and what is our current understanding of the natural history of DCIS?
Sure. So DCIS is just an abbreviation for ductal carcinoma in situ, ductal cancer in situ, which means that there is a cancer within the ducts of the breast, but it is completely confined within the wall of those ducts. So we refer to it as a non-invasive breast cancer. So, you know, there's some debate in the field about whether we should really be calling this breast cancer at all, because it is not an invasive breast cancer, but it is a pretty common diagnosis in the United States. Up to maybe a quarter of newly diagnosed breast cancers are these stage zero non-invasive DCIS lesions. And they're often picked up by mammography. So oftentimes these do not present as a palpable lump. It can in rare circumstances, but generally not. Patients are just going in for screening mammography with no symptoms, a normal breast exam, and they get called back normally because they have calcifications that then get biopsied and come back showing this non-invasive DCIS lesion. So that's typically how we identify it. And, you know, there is a lot of debate. I would say the debate is not so much on the younger end of the spectrum. It's more on the older age of the spectrum, right? If we're screening, you know, women, you know, past 75, you know, a lot of debate is would these lesions really ever become clinically apparent in the patient's lifetime? And you know, are we then subjecting patients to overtreatment and overdiagnosis as a result?
All right. And so in younger patients, then do we think that removing DCIS, you know, decreases the risk of development of invasive cancer and
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so the whole reason why we treat DCIS is because we really think it is a precursor lesion, that if, you know, sort of left alone and untreated over time, that cancer within the duct can start to break through the wall of the duct and start to invade into the surrounding fat of the breast, potentially gaining access to lymphatics and blood vessels. So the main reason that we treat DCIS is to prevent future invasive breast cancer. But that said, there's a really wide range of biology, a whole spectrum. There are some low-grade DCIS lesions that may change very, very slowly, have low potential for transforming into an invasive cancer, and then other lesions that are high-grade and there's a high risk. And so this is where some of the controversy is. We've historically treated all DCIS the same. We excise it to negative margins. Either patients could have a mastectomy or a lumpectomy, but then that would be followed by radiation to the breast. And for patients who have that breast conservation treatment approach, if the DCIS is ER positive, we can also recommend hormonal therapies to further reduce that risk of recurrence. So when DCIS recurs in the breast, half the time it will come back as DCIS and half the time it comes back as an invasive ductal cancer. And so that's really why we're treating it. And again, there is a lot of controversy about DCIS and sort of, you know, trying to get to a place with a more, informed approach based on biology, likely disease course. I would say in younger patients, in general, women who have breast cancers diagnosed at younger ages, they tend to be on the higher risk end of the spectrum. So higher grade and things like that. And so typically, you know, the risk of sort of over-treatment, over-diagnosis is not so much in that group of patients. It's in the older patient population where, you know, the biology is more likely low risk and, you know, big questions about, do we need to put this patient through all of this treatment? Will this, you know, really prevent a future event, right, in her lifetime? So those are the controversies around treatment with DCIS.
Yeah. So I know you mentioned there's kind of low grade, high grade DCIS. Younger patients probably tend to have more high grade lesions and should be resected. And I know this has continued to be studied in the COMET trial. Is there any preliminary data from that so far that would make you feel comfortable with watchful waiting for younger patients with DCIS?
Yeah, I think, you know, there are a number of different strategies being looked at. I think probably more common is, having a surgical resection and potentially omitting radiation and just treating with hormone therapy if the DCIS is ER positive. There are some approaches where there's sort of, no local therapy, so no surgery, no radiation. The COMET trial is randomizing patients with, low risk DCIS only to the standard approach where we would resect it, and again, if lumpectomy, follow that by radiation, or just no surgery, no radiotherapy, but, consider hormone therapy. And so I think, it is an approach. I think people are quite split in terms of, their comfort level with these things. You know, certainly physicians have their own sets of biases. I would just say that, at this point in time, where we have more data is on radiation omission and again, low risk disease. There are a lot of studies going on trying to evaluate that. But generally the standard of care remains today, to treat it. And so I think our approach is to treat it outside of a clinical trial, okay. And not offer routinely in routine clinical practice an active surveillance type of an approach.
All right. Yeah. And you mentioned radiation a few times, and I'm just wondering, just to kind of help support patients going through this, how long are these sessions? How many sessions do they have? How uncomfortable are they? What are short and long-term risks that I should be aware of?
Yeah, so, if we look back historically, we learned that if you just do a lumpectomy, so whether it's a DCIS or an invasive cancer, and you don't do any additional treatment, there's a high rate of a local event in the breast. And we learned through a series of successive clinical trials that giving radiation, a lot of those early studies were radiation to the whole breast, that it certainly reduces the risk of recurrence by about half. So there's clearly a benefit with radiation. Again, those older protocols that we use are about 6.5 weeks long in duration for whole breast radiation. And, things have really changed, I'd say, in the last decade. We're now offering patients shorter courses of radiation than we did in the past. So these sort of what we call hypofractionated approaches. So we're giving a little bit more dose per day per fraction, and overall not going as high on the total cumulative dose as we had in the past. And so for whole breast treatment, you know, it can be done over 3 to 4 weeks, or even some kind of newer approaches doing it over 5 days. There are also for patients with lower risk lesions, rather than treating the entire breast, just treating the partial breast, so around where the lumpectomy was and some a rim of tissue around that. So there have been a lot of advances, and certainly, you know, in terms of from a patient's perspective, you know, the time and sort of effort required to complete radiation, I think, you know, those burdens have been lessened by some of these newer approaches. And so, you know, generally for patients, radiation is a really quick treatment. They typically, before the radiation starts, they'll go in and have a scan, typically a CAT scan, sometimes a PET scan, but for DCIS, it would be like a CAT scan. And that is used just to really kind of get a sense of the anatomy. And the radiation oncologist will work with a medical physicist to come up with the dosimetry. You know, this is the area we want to treat. We want to take it to this dose, and that helps to plan out, you know, the fractionation, how that radiation will be delivered. And then once everything is set up, patients come into the radiation center, and it's a very brief treatment. It takes more time to kind of get undressed and redress than the actual treatment itself. And so, you know, I think techniques have really improved over time. I think for most patients, getting, you know, standard whole breast radiation, they, you know, get through that quite well, I would say. Certainly the big things are, you know, towards the second half, or sometimes even after the radiation is finished, getting some radiation dermatitis of the skin. There's some fatigue that patients have, but, you know, generally, I think compared to some of the other therapies, this is one that patients find, you know, a little bit more straightforward for the most part. Yeah.
All right. And then once the DCIS is treated, should we be screening these patients any differently going forward?
Yeah. So typically, if a patient has a DCIS and they have a lumpectomy, radiation, and maybe if it's ER positive, they're on tamoxifen or an aromatase inhibitor to further reduce risk. Oftentimes we get the first mammogram 6 months out from the completion of radiation. Generally, the radiation oncologist will order that. And then depending on how that area looks, if, you know, the radiologist is happy with the evolution that's happened in that lumpectomy cavity, usually after that, they move to yearly, you know, screening. And so it's general mammography. You know, just having a history of DCIS in the absence of other risk factors isn't an indication for sort of doing more enhanced screening for, you know, with say an MRI. Now we also have, you know, contrast enhanced mammography, which is a newer technique. Yeah, generally it's just going, you know, for mammography and then clinical breast exams.
Okay. And then another biopsy diagnosis that I've encountered quite a bit is atypical ductal hyperplasia. How is that managed or monitored?
Yeah. So some patients will, you know, go in for a screening mammogram. There's a finding. They are recommended for a needle biopsy. And then it comes back with atypia. And so, you know, these needle biopsy samples, they're, you know, 14 gauge core needles that are typically used. And so whenever we see atypia on a core biopsy, the standard is to go in and actually do an excisional biopsy to get a bigger piece of tissue to make sure that it's actually not DCIS or invasive ductal cancer there. So this would be true if it were, you know, any kind of atypia, atypical lobular hyperplasia, atypical ductal hyperplasia. So all of those types of lesions are typically recommended for an excision, just to rule out, you know, some sort of, you know, more invasive or DCIS lesion.
I see. So it sounds like in and of itself, it doesn't necessarily confer increased risk of invasive breast cancer. It's just that there may be
It does. So, you know, there are so many risk factors for breast cancer, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, one that is definitely there is a history of prior breast biopsy, even if it was benign, right? That is a risk factor for subsequent invasive breast cancer. And if you look at atypia, various studies have shown, you know, that there could be a 1.5 to maybe up to 3-fold increase lifetime risk of invasive breast cancer. So patients who do have atypia diagnosed, you know, it is really worthwhile to talk to them about considering something like tamoxifen, raloxifen, aromatase inhibitor for chemo prevention, because, you know, if you think the average risk woman's, you know, risk lifetime for breast cancer is 10 to 12%. If we're starting to look at, you know, 2-fold increased risk or potentially more, there's LCIS that also kind of fits in that category with some of these ALH, ADH lesions. These are all patients that really should be talked to regarding chemo prevention with an endocrine agent.
So many times we're picking up things like DCAS or potential breast cancer on screening mammography. But let's say a patient comes in complaining of what, you know, something they felt or breast pain. I know I usually do an exam, most likely a diagnostic mammogram and a diagnostic ultrasound. If those imaging modalities are normal, but the patient still feels something, when would you consider perhaps either further imaging or a breast surgeon referral instead of just reassurance?
I think it's a great question and a really important one. Breast cancer, you know, in some cases can be very straightforward to diagnose. And in other cases, you know, it can be completely occult on standard mammographic imaging on ultrasound. And so, you know, when patients come in with a complaint, you know, it's important, yes, to order the right imaging test. And typically, if they have a symptom, it's a diagnostic study. So the only difference between a diagnostic and a screening is that the radiologist, the breast imager, is involved in real time in the study and directing what happens. And so, you know, I think that if there is a palpable finding and, you know, the imaging comes back, you know, the mammography doesn't show anything, and, you know, there's not really any kind of suspicious lesion that's identified on ultrasound, certainly, you know, that can be reassuring. But if there is a palpable finding and the ultrasound doesn't suggest that it's a cyst or anything like that, right? Then I think it is important to have short, you know, interval follow-up with the patient just to kind of continue to monitor that area. And if it's persisting, if anything is changing, you know, just always very, very low threshold to refer to a breast surgeon. Breast surgeons are seeing patients with breast-related complaints all the time. And, you know, really having patients assessed by someone with expertise in breast disease, I think can really be helpful because, you know, the last thing that you want to do is, you know, reassure a patient and all along it's a breast cancer. Certainly listen to the patients, right? If they're saying my imaging, you know, was negative, but I feel this thing still, and it's like, it's different for me. Patients have a strong sense of it. And if it's growing, right, just really low threshold to refer them, you know, sometimes they do need advanced imaging, MRI, other things, as part of the workup. And so, you know, certainly we evaluate a lot of, you know, benign or disease or suspected breast cancer in our breast surgery clinic before patients have any diagnosis. So it's absolutely appropriate to just refer the patient.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then moving on to invasive breast cancer, you know, a lot of information comes back on that core biopsy report. And as primary care providers, again, we're often the first ones to review this with patients. And I know that things like, you know, that you've mentioned, ER, PR, positivity, HER2 status is really important for potential treatment options. But what are other aspects of the PATH report? Do you think it's important for primary care providers to understand?
Yeah, there's a lot packed in there. I think if you look at, you know, sort of these reports after a core biopsy, and you're absolutely right. I think in the past, you know, we used to, if patients had some sort of a breast complaint, they saw a breast surgeon and typically had an excisional biopsy. But now, you know, often it's a radiologist who is making a diagnosis of breast cancer, right? And those results are then coming back to the primary care, the, you know, gynecologist who ordered those tests. And then, you know, you have it, right? And you need to talk to the patient. So histology is, you know, I think, you know, the first thing that is commented on. So is this a ductal, if it's an invasive cancer, is it an invasive ductal cancer? Is this a lobular cancer? Sometimes you'll see that they just call it carcinoma and they can't really characterize it. So that's, you know, kind of the first thing that you'll see on the report. And then the next thing is sort of comment around how big was the cancer in the core needle biopsy. So a 14 gauge core needle is a pretty, you know, big needle. It's sort of a little thicker probably than a lead in a typical number two pencil. And the samples that are, you know, taken are, you know, 1 to 2 centimeters in length. So we always look at how much cancer is there. Is it 1 millimeter? Is it 10 millimeters on the core? And then looking at the grade, right? So grade is really important. So cancers can be low grade, intermediate grade, or high grade. So grade 1, 2, 3. And so definitely the high grade lesions, you know, these are sort of, you know, ones that are likely patients that are likely to be recommended for more intense treatment. Again, kind of looking at all everything, the patient's age, the size of the tumor, all of these things. There is a comment on whether they see in and around the tumor, like evidence of angiolymphatic invasion. So can they see little tumor cells in the lymphatics or the blood vessels? But the big thing that is done on every invasive cancer is, you know, one of these breast cancer prognostic marker panels, which they all include ER, the estrogen receptor, PR, the progesterone receptor, and HER2. Some of them will include a fourth marker, which is Ki-67. It's a marker of proliferation. So the way I usually explain it to patients is that estrogen receptors and progesterone receptors, they're normally present in the breast. When a breast cancer develops, many times the breast cancer just keeps on making estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor, but sometimes it stops. So roughly a third of the time, we don't really understand why, but the ERPR status is important. You know, is it ER positive, progesterone receptor positive, or are those negatives? So if it's a negative ER, negative PR, that's sort of automatically a higher risk cancer. And then there's, you know, it's not black and white. There's a lot of shades of gray, right? Sometimes it's ER positive, but it may be 2% ER positive. So it's essentially ER negative, right? And so there's a spectrum of how ER positive these cancers are. And then the third marker is HER2, a really important marker to assay. HER2 is again present in normal breast tissue, but in about 20, maybe upwards to 25% of cancers, HER2 is overproduced. So it's amplified at the gene level, overexpressed at the protein level, and it's a real kind of marker of a more aggressive cancer. So when that HER2 is positive, and a lot of the details around how that is determined, it's kind of complicated when you look at the reports. There's the protein testing by immunohistochemistry, and then there's the kind of gene amplification testing by FISH. But usually they will report out like the overall result, positive versus negative, looking at all of the data from those two tests. But a HER2 positive cancer, again, a more aggressive cancer. These are patients that pretty much will be, for the most part, recommended to have chemotherapy and a more intense treatment. So, you know, I think that, you know, it's good to give patients a sense of that, right? I think patients read it and are overwhelmed. The other marker that, again, many of the panels include is the Ki-67. And it's just, again, it's a protein stain immunohistochemistry that sort of divide stain cells that are actively dividing. So a pretty slow growing indolent cancer might have a Ki-67 of 5%, where a really aggressive cancer, it could be 50, 60, 70% or higher. So a more aggressive lesion. So those are all, I think, things, you know, to look at. And it does help, right, for the patient to really understand that, because not only do these markers inform prognosis, but also, you know, they're predictive for response to specific classes of treatment. So these are really important, and want to always make sure that, because we rely in medical oncology so much on these markers, right, that they're accurate and really kind of make sense in the context of what's going on in the with the patient.
I see. Thank you for walking through all those details. So it sounds like having ERPR positive, HER2 negative, low Ki-67, smaller size, low grade, no lymphatic invasion are kind of the most favorable findings. Okay. And then I'm curious, you know, I'm wondering what the verbiage you use to discuss these findings with patients during that first meeting. And let's say they had, you know, all those positive findings. You know, I don't want to be overly reassuring or give false hope, but, you know, obviously breast cancer treatments have improved so much over the last couple of decades. Are there certain patients where you might tell them based on their pathology report that, you know, breast cancer is very treatable, survival rates are good? You know, what verbiage are you using?
Yeah, all of those things. I think, you know, I do walk through, you know, this just like I did for you, the ERPR, HER2 Ki-67, and you know, just explain that for any given cancer, the cancer can have any combination of those markers. And, you know, I think it's important for them to understand that ERPR negative is unfavorable, that having those markers positive is favorable. HER2 positivity is unfavorable, right? So I use language like that, favorable, unfavorable. And that, again, you can have any pattern, right? All three can be positive, triple positive. You can have all three negative, triple negative. Some can be positive, others negative, but it really kind of gives some information around, you know, what's the likely prognosis. So there are certain patterns that are more favorable than other patterns with ERPR positive, especially when the ERPR is really strong you know, expressed in a high percentage of the tumor cells. When it's positive and the HER2 is negative, that's sort of the most common pattern that we see, and certainly the most favorable. But again, you know, grade can influence. Sometimes we'll see an ERPR positive tumor that's HER2 negative, but it's really high grade. Mm-hmm. And so that's different from one that's like grade one with the same markers, right? And so I think grade is really important as well. Because at, you know, with any of those marker sort of combinations, you can have a more aggressive biology for sure.
Yeah, sounds like a wide variation.
Yes.
Yeah. And then next, can you walk me through kind of the staging pathway for invasive breast cancer?
Yeah. So oftentimes, you know, patients they will, you know, see us after, you know, they felt something, a lump in the breast, and then were referred for diagnostic breast imaging, or something was identified on just screening breast imaging and was recommended for biopsy. So often they'll come to us with a core biopsy, with a diagnosis. And so, you know, what we do in that first visit, we really want to look at the imaging. So the mammogram, the ultrasound, try to get a sense of what the imaging is suggesting in terms of the stage. How big is this lesion in the breast? Does it look like any lymph nodes are involved? Oftentimes with mammogram, ultrasound, you can get that information about lymph nodes in the axilla, whether they're abnormally enlarged or not. So we really look carefully at the imaging, and then we carefully look at the patient because sometimes there's imaging that suggests something that's quite small, but then you do an exam and you're worried about clinically, on clinical exam, that it's actually a more advanced process than suggested by the imaging. So it's important to do a good clinical exam to get a sense, really, to measure using calipers, what's the size of, you know, if there is something palpable in the breast, how big is it? Where is it? Is it involving the nipple, the areola? What do we feel in terms of the lymph node? Is there anything in the axilla, the infraclavicular lymph nodes, the supraclavicular lymph nodes? And then often, you know, we kind of have this discussion around, you know, additional imaging. So for all patients, you know, we do the initially just a history and exam, you know, ask them for any, you know, symptoms like Rubio systems around any symptoms that could potentially suggest metastatic disease. And then, you know, do a physical exam, kind of looking for those things too. Typically, we'll order body imaging, so some sort of systemic staging for patients where we think it's a stage 3 cancer. And for patients where we think it's clinically stage 1 or stage 2, we often will get comprehensive labs, and we don't routinely recommend body imaging. But if there are any signs or symptoms that raise a question, we have a low threshold to order it. But generally, you know, if you look in the United States, it's quite uncommon for patients who at the time of initial diagnosis to have metastatic disease. So it's around 6% of patients who get diagnosed with stage 4 disease at the time they first present. So I try to explain that to patients too, to reassure them. And then a big question that always happens is, you know, do we need additional imaging of the breast? And, you know, do we order an MRI of the breast to evaluate for extent of disease? So again, there's some controversy over that, concern that we're overutilizing breast MRI, and that it's leading to additional findings that are kind of pushing patients to then, you know, choose mastectomy or bilateral mastectomy. And so are we really kind of serving patients by doing that? Certainly, you know, any lobular breast cancer, we order an MRI because it is, you know, known that lobular breast cancers are not imaged well on standard mammography and ultrasound. So for lobular cancers, we're going to get an MRI. Typically, younger patients, or if the breast tissue is really dense, it's hard, you know, there's decreased sensitivity for mammography. And so that's typically a situation where we are going to order an MRI. And so, you know, it's a lot of times a surgeon, you know, kind of making that decision for MRI or not. I would say, you know, certainly quite a good percentage of patients are getting an MRI at diagnosis. You know, often the patients who really don't need it are, say, an older woman who's postmenopausal, has a, you know, very fatty replaced breast. You have an excellent image with a mammogram, and it's a lower end of the spectrum risk cancer, ER positive, right? There's not really a lot of benefit in an MRI in that situation. And we would just use, you know, the mammogram and ultrasound to direct the surgical treatment. So I think, yeah, that's one of the things that we try to decide, who needs MRI. And it does, you know, help to look at the lymph nodes. It looks at internal mammary chain of lymph nodes, which run, you know, on the, sort of the side of the, sternum. Those are regional lymph nodes of the breast that we don't otherwise visualize, with mammogram or ultrasound. So if a tumor has a very medial location, even though typically we feel that no matter where a tumor is in the breast, typically the lymphatic drainage is to the axilla. If it's a medially, sort of located tumor, it could just spread to the internal mammary chain. And the only real way to look at that is you know, with an MRI or a PET scan, something like that. So those are other kind of factors that we think about, kind of where is the tumor in the breast and should, do we feel we need to evaluate those lymph nodes? And that could be an indication for ordering MRI.
Yeah, it was interesting to me that you mentioned that sometimes you can see some of that lymph node involvement on the mammogram or ultrasound. Certainly you see many more cases than mm-hmm. I must say I haven't seen that on a report. I'm curious if we don't see any mention of lymph nodes on the diagnostic mammogram or ultrasound, is that generally more, good. Much more favorable? Okay. So it's a...
Yeah. So, when they do the mammogram, right, there's the CC view where the breast is compressed and the beam is directed cranial caudal. And then instead of doing a true lateral image, it is a medial lateral oblique. So the breast is compressed. And the idea is to really go all the way up and get that breast tissue that is coming and extending into the axillary tail. And so that's right where the lymph nodes are. And so sometimes on that MLO view of the mammogram, you can see if they're lots of lymph nodes, they're very visible on that projection. And so if it's a more locally advanced case, like it will be often seen on the mammogram, the lymph node involvement, but only there. It doesn't look at the neck and it doesn't look at the internal mammary chain, right? But
right.
Yeah.
Okay, got it. And I still remember being very tired, standing in the OR, watching sentinel lymph node biopsies as a medical student. Are those still kind of routinely done for everyone with invasive breast cancer during either their mastectomy or lumpectomy?
Yeah, so, for invasive breast cancers, for the most part, we feel that, the axillary lymph nodes, it's standard to sample them. In the past, all patients went in and had a complete axillary lymph node dissection, level one, level two. And many times, patients had 18, 20, 25 lymph nodes removed and they were all negative. And that left patients with risks of long-term morbidity related to arm function, lymphedema, things like that. So the sentinel node biopsy came along really with the idea that if you have a tumor in the breast, if those cells are leaving the breast and heading, getting into the lymphatics and heading to the regional lymph nodes, you should be able to identify that kind of pattern of lymphatic spread. And the first lymph node where something would land if it was going to get out can be identified as the sentinel lymph node. And over years and with different clinical trials, it was shown that if you identify a sentinel lymph node and remove that lymph node, sometimes it's a group of lymph nodes in that area, if those are negative, that is incredibly unlikely that any other lymph nodes are involved. And so our approach now is if the sentinel lymph node is negative, then the axillary surgery is over. So it's really helped to, decrease, the number of nodes that have been taken for patients. It has been very widely utilized. There are situations sometimes, patients who maybe are older and it looks like a low tumor, there's a low grade tumor, small size, low stage. Do we really need to do a sentinel node? So there are some cases where we may think about, it's safe to omit it. But in general, for invasive breast cancer, a sentinel node biopsy is typically the approach. If there are clearly involved nodes clinically, we can see them on ultrasound, MRI, mammogram. We often will do a biopsy, a core needle biopsy of the lymph node. And in those cases, there's no point for a sentinel node. So it's really for patients where we think the axilla is clinically negative. Those are the patients that are recommended for sentinel node biopsy.
Okay. And it's nice to hear that we're overall kind of making breast cancer treatments more tolerable. You mentioned the radiation doses coming down, less axillary dissections.
Yeah. All good trends. Yeah.
Yes. And then another common question, I think one of the first questions patients always ask me is if they're going to need chemotherapy. And I know you mentioned one example of if they're HER2 positive, they're most likely going to need anything I can gather from the PATH report that, because often I don't have all that extra information to kind of preliminarily answer that question for patients.
So what I would say is that in general, the majority of patients will have a recommendation for chemotherapy if the cancer is HER2 positive, if the ER/PR is negative. For the more common cancers that we see that are ER/PR positive, HER2 negative, most patients will not be recommended for chemotherapy, but there are some patients who have higher grade tumors, more sort of high genomic risk, that are recommended. So I would say for those that are ER/PR positive and HER2 negative, it is, you know, possible that chemotherapy would be recommended. But certainly, you know, the majority of patients would not receive that recommendation.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So it's kind of helpful, at least.
Yeah. I think patients love hearing that. Yeah. And then, as I mentioned earlier when I was introducing you, you've played a role in the development of PARP inhibitors, which are targeted therapies that improve the prognosis for breast cancer patients with BRCA gene mutations. Can you talk more about the significance of this and other progress that we've made in precision medicine for breast cancer?
Yeah, it's been a really kind of exciting last 10 years, I would say. We've started to get more targeted therapies approved in the metastatic treatment setting. And typically, when we identify drugs that are active in advanced or metastatic breast cancer, the next thing we do is we think about, okay, can we identify patients who have early stage curable breast cancer where the risk of recurrence is high? And what if we add some of these treatments for those patients, sort of layer them in as additional adjuvant treatment? Can that help to reduce recurrence and improve survival? And I think we've, you know, really started to see in the last 5 years or so for breast cancer, more and more therapies coming in. HER2 positive breast cancer, you know, this is old news there. We've been kind of doing targeted therapy with the HER2 directed antibodies for nearly 20 years now. But for the other subtypes of breast cancer, beyond chemotherapy and the endocrine agents, there weren't additional treatments. And so that's starting to change. So we've seen for early stage triple negative breast cancer, immunotherapy, so PD-1 inhibitor, become a standard of care for high risk triple negative breast cancer, stage 2 or stage 3. So that's been great. We've seen for patients who have high risk breast cancer associated with an inherited mutation in the BRCA1 or BRCA2 genes, the ability to take an additional treatment, an oral PARP inhibitor. And lately, some of the big advance has been in ER positive, HER2 negative breast cancer, but high risk based on either advanced stage or other high risk features. We're starting to see some of these CDK4/6 inhibitors, so the cyclin-dependent kinase 4/6 inhibitors that have been so successful in the metastatic setting, starting to get indications for high risk early stage disease. So, you know, it's been a period of a lot of activity. We're seeing a lot of new FDA approvals in early breast cancer, really, again, trying to pull out the high-risk patients, right? And, you know, not give all of these additional treatments to patients with lower risks of disease. But it's been great to see. And I think, you know, it's definitely making an impact in the clinic. We feel that.
Yeah. Okay. I didn't know we had some targeted therapies for triple negative disease. I think stage 2 or 3 you mentioned.
Yeah. So just the immunotherapy, that's just been in the last few years. So a lot of these approvals have just come in really the last, you know, 5-ish years. And so, you know, I think we're going to be seeing more and more of these new treatments coming in.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's great. And I'm sure that has had a lot of positive impact on survival rates. But I also want to get to, you know, we often think about cancer in terms of survival rates, but, you know, I want to also emphasize kind of the short and long-term impacts of these breast cancer treatments. We've talked a bit about anti-estrogen therapies for ER-positive patients. Can you talk more about those short and long-term side effects of agents like tamoxifen, aromatase inhibitors?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's something that we struggle with a lot, right? I think just general, when we give these adjuvant treatments, right? We know that, you know, we take 100 patients with the same features, there's a group of them that are at risk of recurrence, a larger number who are going to be just fine, you know, and not destined to recur. With, say, for example, local treatment alone. But we have to decide, you know, does the risk of the cancer rise to the level where we feel we need to treat? But we have to treat everyone, all 100, to benefit that small group. And that's just kind of the inherent kind of tension with adjuvant therapies. That we know everyone is getting toxicity, but not everyone is getting benefit. And so I think it's important, you know, to explain that to patients. I think, you know, in other cancers where adjuvant treatments are kind of common, like breast cancer is a great example of where we give all these adjuvant treatments to further reduce recurrence. You know, we know that we're over-treating patients, right? And so that's why the work is all about how do we better identify the patients who really need it and not give these things like de-escalate or de-intensify the treatment for those with a more favorable risk. So with the hormone therapies, you know, in general, whether it's an aromatase inhibitor or tamoxifen, in terms of long-term risks, the drugs are, you know, really have an excellent long-term safety profile. I think the bigger issue for patients with the endocrine therapies, since they may be on these treatments for 5 years minimum, sometimes longer, sometimes up to 10 years, it's really the quality of life impacts, right? So vasomotor symptoms, vaginal dryness, arthralgia. So these are really the common sort of issues that patients can feel day to day. And it can make, you know, it hard for patients to really feel eager to stay on. And so, you know, if we look at the aromatase inhibitors, some of the long-term risks that we worry about are more, it's more related to impact on bone density. So many patients will not have an impact, a negative impact in terms of bone density, but some patients will have accelerated bone loss. So we need to monitor that. And then with tamoxifen, you know, there are rare but serious potential side effects that are always important to talk about, you know, including the risk of, you know, venous thromboembolism, but also, you know, in some rare cases, typically in older postmenopausal women, risks for uterine cancer. So these are this is an uncommon event. There also can be an uncommon event related to cataract, accelerated cataract formation with tamoxifen. So there are definitely some long-term risks and potentially serious risks that we need to counsel patients about. But generally, you know, compared to some of the other treatments that we do, like the chemotherapies, the biggest issue for patients, I think, is kind of the on-treatment sort of quality of life and side effects, the day-to-day symptoms that they're having.
Right, right. And I think I hear about that a lot in terms of the vaginal dryness and dyspareunia in general. And then my understanding is that topical vaginal estrogens are generally considered safe for women who've been treated with breast cancer due to the pretty low systemic absorption. But are there scenarios in which you would even advise against topical vaginal estrogen?
I'm very comfortable with it. I don't see you know, that there is a situation where I would say we need to avoid it. I can't think of one off the top of my head. I think the big thing is that there are different vaginal estrogen preparations. And so the ones that we think are typically safe are kind of the lower potency ones. So there are some that, you know, are higher potency and have a higher risk of systemic absorption. You know, generally, you know, the risk is really, in my mind, it's really for patients who are on aromatase inhibitors, because what we're trying to do with an aromatase inhibitor is take the estrogen and turn it off, right? And, you know, estrogen deprivation is the way that those drugs work. And so if the patient is using a high potency vaginal estrogen on a daily basis, that could potentially undermine, you know, what we're trying to achieve with the aromatase inhibitor. But typically preparations, lower potency preparations like Estrace, estradiol vaginal cream or Vagifem, these are, you know, very safe options. And, you know, I think, you know, there's general comfort in using them for patients for symptom control.
Okay, great. And then you also mentioned vasomotor symptoms, how that patients experience when they're on these anti-androgen therapies. Which non-hormonal agents have you found to be kind of most effective in helping these patients manage their vasomotor symptoms?
I think everyone is really, you know, worried about these things. You know, what we tend to see are, you know, really the most challenging ages are 45 to 55 when a patient is diagnosed and recommended to start these drugs during that time. This is when some of these hormonal shifts are happening naturally anyway, and then we're coming in with the treatment and sort of fanning the flames. So patients who are really young, who are on, you know, having regular menstrual periods on tamoxifen, generally they have no vasomotor symptoms at all. But then you give it to someone who's 48 and kind of in that perimenopause period, likely a lot of side effects. On the other hand, if someone is 70 years old and you start them on an aromatase inhibitor, they may have a little bit of an uptick in hot flashes, but they tend to, you know, just go away pretty quickly. So, you know, it's important to give the patient a sense of, do we think this is going to be like a major issue for them? And so I think in my experience, generally 45 to 55, that's when it can be challenging, but everyone is different. And some patients, you know, have really long lasting hot flashes, like, you know, well past natural menopause. So, you know, we talk to patients about, you know, whether it's really just like kind of more a nighttime issue. You know, some patients are like, I'm fine in the day, but then I keep waking up at night and I feel hot and, you know, I need to take off the covers and it's interrupting my sleep. So if it's more like nighttime dominant, something like gabapentin can be really helpful. So it's sort of an off-label use, for hot flashes, but can definitely be helpful. So just 300 to 600 milligrams at nighttime is often all that's needed. If it's all the time, like if it's daytime, nighttime, then generally, you know, we think about something like Effexor. extended release, just to take once a day. There are some newer drugs, right, that are sort of novel mechanism of action that patients, you know, who have challenges, right, with still having a lot of hot flashes despite gabapentin, Effexor, or something like that. You know, we're starting to try more. You know, we do send patients, you know, to gynecology. You know, some gynecologists who really have an interest in, you know, menopause. We have a new sort of center for menopause at Stanford, which is great. And so we're sending a lot of our patients there for having these symptoms. But you know, it can be limiting for patients, certainly. I think generally those symptoms are less limiting. I think probably the arthralgias, the joint symptoms, are, in my experience, the thing that makes it most challenging for patients to stay on certain therapies sometimes.
Okay. And then what are you generally recommending for the arthralgias? I mean, I assume we tried Tylenol.
Yeah. I mean, you know, unfortunately, it's sort of like a stiffness. It's not really like a severe pain, but a patient's just feel like creaky and stiff, and it's just, they feel it all the time, right? You sit down for a while, you get up, you feel just like super stiff. Wake up in the morning right away, stiff, right? And so, you know, a lot of times we just try to tell patients it's, you know, important that you talk to us, right? And, you know, certainly we want to give you a benefit of the therapy, but we don't want to make you miserable every day for 5 years. And so if they're just intolerable side effects, then we're going to stop it, let it wash out, and then try something different, right? We have options in terms of different endocrine agents. And so sometimes for some patients, switching from one aromatase inhibitor to another, there is a difference. For others, they switch from one to the other, they still have it. But generally then a switch to tamoxifen is really, can be really helpful for patients. And so there are options. I think a lot of patients, you know, just will stop taking it, or maybe say, I'm going to just take it every other day. I can't handle feeling like this, or I'm going on vacation, so I'm going to not take it, right? And so it's just important that patients understand, like, yeah, we know that it can be hard to take it. If you're having problems, just be open with us and let's try to problem solve it together. And there are alternatives, right? If this is a drug that's really hard for you to tolerate. So there, you know, there are options for that, but generally it's just switching therapy is really the best approach.
I see. And then, can you talk about the psychological impacts of going through breast cancer treatments and how primary care providers can best support our patients?
Yeah, I think, you know, for most patients, and this is true with breast cancer, but really any cancer, you know, I think when patients hear that they have a diagnosis of cancer, they just feel like, you know, everything has turned upside down in their life. And it's a very kind of scary just super stressful time for patients. From, you know, learning that there is breast cancer and then the time, right, where you have to go through additional testing, waiting for appointments. A lot of patients, that is the period where patients are really, you know, they can become just very, very stressed out and dysregulated, like not sleeping, not eating well. And so, you know, I think it's important just to you know, let patients know that, yeah, these are all normal feelings, right? Everyone like who has a serious illness diagnosed and they're first hearing that information, they feel that's how they feel, right? That it's kind of a normal reaction. And I usually try to tell patients, you know, that this early part, like the workup and kind of figuring out what the plan is going to be, it's just like filled with uncertainty and worry. And I often try to just tell patients that once we, you know, have a treatment plan and you start, everything starts to feel better, right? And so I think that, you know, it, just supporting patients if they're having, you know, really difficult time with not being able to sleep or kind of lots of intrusive thoughts, right? Benzodiazepines can be helpful for patients. And then just, you know, kind of keeping contact with them, right? And I think what helps is kind of trying to get appointments as quickly as possible, coming up with a treatment plan. And then, you know, it starts to feel better. I think at the once the treatment, the acute phase of the treatment is over, that can be that post-treatment period, another kind of really vulnerable time for people. You know, they think, okay, it's finally over. You know, I did it. But then I think once it's over, patients look back on kind of what just happened and really feel sad about it. So I think when patients are often feeling my mood will soar and life is going to be better, they're sort of surprised to find that, you know, they have a lot of anxieties, right, about recurrence and, you know, sort of sadness about what's just happened to them and how it's impacted them, their family, their life. And so, you know, I think, you know, that initial diagnosis is a very vulnerable period. And then the post-treatment, like when we say, okay, you're all finished and we'll see you in 3 months, you know, patients are like, how am I going to survive on my own for 3 months? Right. Because even though it's not pleasant going through all these treatments, when you're there coming in frequently, you know, you're being seen, you're being cared for, and then suddenly it's over. And then you feel patients feel sort of like they're on their own. Right. And so, you know, I just, again, explain to people that that's kind of a normal kind of, you know, group of feelings that most patients have as they kind of make their way, you know, through the diagnosis, the treatment, and move into that surveillance mode.
Yeah. I'm glad you emphasized that kind of post-treatment feelings. And I've definitely seen a lot of that in my practice as well. You know, this feeling like, oh, I'm supposed to be celebratory that I'm done, but really there's still a lot of anxiety, stress, or fatigue, or long-term emotional impacts from having gone through what they did.
And I think for a lot of patients, you know, when it's over, you know, everyone is like, including family. And I think, you know, people who are really close to them, they're like, okay, it's over. Like, and so in their mind, it's over, right? And let's just like go forward. But for a lot of patients, like, it's very much not over, right? The treatment may be over, but, you know, it's still, you know, consuming a lot of, you know, thoughts and on their mind very much front and center for a while, even after the treatment is over. And so, you know, just again, like, that's normal, right? Kind of normalizing it. And it is, right? A lot of, you just have to kind of work through it. I always tell patients, you know, as with everything in life, time heals, right? As you get further away from it, right, it's going to feel better. And, you know, they will kind of get back to their old self. It may take a while, right, for them to feel like they have their feet under them again, but they'll get back to that place.
Yeah. And then in terms of that concern for and monitoring for recurrence, what are kind of common sites of metastasis for breast cancer? You mentioned doing a very specific review of systems during your intake. What symptoms should we be specifically asking patients at these follow-up visits?
Yeah, so we typically kind of go over how, you know, if they're on endocrine therapy, you know, how is that treatment going? What are the problems they're having? How can we, you know, kind of, you know, address those things? But then just kind of going through questions, you know, are you having any headache, double vision, back pain, bone pain, any changes in the breast, you know, in the armpit, in the arm, any abdominal pain, right? Just like going through those things. And, you know, generally, if you look at national guidelines, you know, in the United States and really across the world, there's no recommended beyond breast imaging, right? There isn't any recommended scanning. I think a lot of times patients find that really surprising, right? Like, Because for other cancers, you know, routine, like every, you know, 3 month, 6 month CAT scans may be a routine, but for breast cancer, there have been clinical trials done, you know, looking at how best to follow a patient who's been treated curatively for breast cancer. And, you know, looking at kind of intensive lab monitoring, you know, chest, liver imaging versus just history and exam and, you know, ordering studies if there's any kind of concerning sign or symptom. And all of those studies show that, you know, again, women do equally well, and that doing routine lab work and routine, you know, chest and abdominal imaging, it doesn't really buy anything in terms of a benefit. And so it's different for some other cancer types. And so sometimes patients have a hard time, you know, like believing like, really, there's like nothing. But, you know, things are, you know, changing. You know, I think as we look to the future, I think some of these newer blood tests that look at detecting very small fragments of circulating tumor DNA, they may increasingly be incorporated into surveillance and follow-up. There's, you know, they're powerful, powerful tools. We're right now trying to learn how best to use them, right? And so I think that generally, you know, we examine the patients, do a careful breast exam, or even if there's been a mastectomy, a chest wall and nodal exam, and make sure they're getting their breast imaging on time. And, you know, generally we have a very low threshold, right? If there's anything new or different to image. So we would order whatever imaging modality the symptom kind of is, you know, dictates. So that's what I tell patients. And, you know, it's, again, a lot of fear, right? Patients feel like after breast cancer, oftentimes patients are sort of shocked, like, how is it that I have stage 3 breast cancer? I felt totally fine. And so they feel almost like their body has, you know, deceived them, right? Like, why didn't I pick up some sign or know about this earlier? I had no idea. And so I think, you know, patients as a result, even at a very subconscious level, you know, are kind of scanning and really being hyper aware of like what their body is telling them. And so it's a normal reaction, right? And, you know, it's something, you know, our minds do, right? Like this kind of vigilance around symptoms, but it can also be really distressing because any little pain or this or that, right? Patients can start to worry like, oh my gosh, is this my breast cancer? And so there can be a lot of anxiety. So I usually tell patients, you know, while we're going to see you in 3 months or 4 months, you know, if you have something going on between now and then, don't hold on to it, right? Call us, like sometimes just talking through it. You know, can help to, you know, relieve the worry around it. And that, again, it, as patients get more experience with, you know, being a breast cancer survivor, they're like, okay, I'm kind of better able to sort through some of these kind of things now. But it's hard in the beginning for patients.
Yeah. And for all those reasons, I'm very grateful that we have a kind of cancer survivorship program here at Stanford, which my patients have found very helpful as well. And
absolutely.
Then, yeah, thank you so much for kind of sharing your insights and knowledge today. Is there anything else that you would like primary care providers to know about breast cancer treatments or just some kind of key takeaways that you'd like us to have?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's great, right? I think, you know, trying, it's always hard, I think, for, you know, primary care providers, you know, when there's something, a big diagnosis like this and all these things happening to kind of keep track. You know, we're always happy to chat by phone, right? Just as a touch base, if there are questions about a patient. And I think, you know, trying to, you know, maybe at the end of treatment, like, you know, just have some communication around, you know, what's coming next, right, for the patient, how they did. And I think, you know, there's definitely been some efforts around that with some of these survivorship care plans and things like that. Not always the easiest thing to implement in practice for all patients, but sort of efforts in that direction. But it is helpful, I think, for patients when they feel like their primary care provider has a sense of what's happening to them, right? And I think it really helps to just make the transition post-treatment, smoother for patients. And so we're always here. And, if you want to ever talk about a patient or get an update post-treatment, sometimes a phone call can just be like a really easy way to do it.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much for saying that. And thank you again for all your time today.
All right. Thank you. It's been great.